third speaker is Clementine Roriz. And please, try to encourage her. She had almost a catastrophic failure in the morning, so she almost actually lost her talk. But she's strong and ready to go. So she's going to talk about reverse engineering inter-last level CAS complex addressing using performance calculus.
Thank you for the presentation. So this is a joint work with Nicolas Descornet, Christophe Neumann, and Olivier from Technicolor, and Aurélien Francillon from Miricom. So first of all, why are we interested in reverse engineering the last level cache addressing? So I have to thank Marc Sivan for the nice introduction this morning on this topic. So I actually followed the inverse path. I was interested in cache attacks at the beginning, and along those lines, the cache attacks part is really what's at the core of this paper. And along the work on the cache attacks, we were interested also in Rohammer, and we also used this work to build a Rohammer in JavaScript. So I'm going to talk, this is not really the core of this paper, but I'm going to give a brief explanation of this at the end of the talk. So I'm interested in information leakage, and when you have processes that share the same hardware, even if there is some software isolation, like virtual machines or sandboxes, you can have some information leakage between your processes. So this is really a known problem. There is a lot of work on this. For example, the processes can share the memory, so they can use the memory deduplication or the memory bus to perform the attacks. And they can use the processor itself, so either branch prediction unit, arithmetic logic unit, or the cache, which is the part I'm interested about. Now the thing is, these attacks are really highly dependent on the hardware. You have to know really well how it works to be able to perform the attack. And the hardware change a lot. For example, Intel manufacture a new microarchitecture pretty much every year. And the hardware is most of the time not documented, because it's really the features are really critical in terms of performance, and the manufacturer don't seem really eager to document this. So this is why we perform some reverse engineering. So more on CPU caches. So the caches are designed to improve performance. So it's really a type of memory that is called SRAM that is very fast, but that is also very expensive. So we have small caches, a few megabytes at most. And because it is very very small, all your data cannot fit into the memory. So you have different timings for different memory accesses. And you have many two cases. Either data is present in the cache, it's called a cache hit, and it's going to be fast access, or data is not present in the cache, it's called a cache miss, and it's going to be a slow access. So fortunately, we have some memory isolation, which means that one process cannot just look into what's in the cache for another process. But due to these fast and slow accesses, we can perform indirect measurements instead. So you have two types of attacks on this. So the first is covert channels. So this is a communication between two processes that should not communicate with each other. And they're going to cooperate to communicate. And the second attack is side channels, where an attacker is going to spy a victim process. So no cooperation here. So this is a very high-level view on how the processor looks like. So you have several cores, here four cores, and you have a hierarchy of different levels of caches. So you first have level 1 and level 2 that are private to each core, which means that the core 0 can access only his level 1 and his level 2, and not level 1 and level 2 of, for example, core 3. And then you have the last level cache, which is divided in different slices, as many slices as cores, but they are all shared by all cores, which means that core 0 can access slice 0, but also slice 1, 2, and 3. So internally, the caches are organized in sets. So this is one set, and inside the set we have different lines. And one line is loaded in a particular set, only depending on its address. And where in this set precisely is depending on the replacement policy, which decide which line we should evict to store a new one. So there is a lot of different cache attacks. The class of attack I'm interested is access-driven attack. And this is quite a powerful attack because the attacker is going to monitor only its object activity to determine which of the cache sets accessed by the victim process. So we have two types of access-driven attacks. The first one is called flush plus reload. And in this one, we need some shared memory, and we also need the CLFlush instruction, which flushes cache lines from all the cache hierarchy. And the second one is called Prevent Probe, in which we don't have any shared memory. So in some environments, in particular in cloud environments, some providers decided that we should disable shared memory because of security concerns. So while flush plus reload is really powerful and also more easier to do, it won't work in this environment. So I'm interested more in the Prime Probe attacks. So this has been introduced by Percival. And on the last year, we had lots of new papers to do this really on the last file cache. So the first step for the attacker is to fill the cache. So this is the prime step. And then the attacker wants to know which, the attacker is going to let the victim perform what it wants to spy, and once the victim performs this process, it's going to load data into the cache. So the set is not infinite, so to load data, the victim has to evict some of the data that was put here by the attacker. So here it evicts one line of the attacker, and here another line. Now the attacker wants to determine if this particular set was accessed by the victim. And to do this, he's going to probe his own data to determine if the set was accessed. So here on the first line, the attacker has the first access. And here on the second line, this line was evicted by the victim, which means that it's not in the cache and it's going to be a slow access. So just by measuring the time it takes to do its own probing, the attacker was able to know if this particular cache set was accessed by the victim. So to perform these attacks, we need to know very precisely where in the cache a line is going to be loaded. And we have one big issue, that is the complex addressing on the last level cache. So the first step to know where a physical address is going to be in the cache is to know in which slice it's going to be. So there is a hash function that takes into input some bits of the physical address and output the slice. And then the set is also decided by some bits of the physical address. Now the big issue we have is that this hash function is not documented. The irony here is that this hasn't been designed for security, this addressing function, but it has been designed by for performance. And this is one of the very few cases where we have a feature for performance and it doesn't make attacks easier to do. It does, it limits them. So, due to this issue, it means that with a complex addressing, it's impossible for an attacker to target a set in the cache. So, we're going to reverse engineer this complex addressing function to have some fine-grained cache attacks and to be able to evict a single set. So, in input, we have some bits of the physical address and in output, k bits of the slice, depending on the number of slice. And there have been some previous workers from Detal who did some preliminary work on this. They have reversed the function for one CPU using a timing attack concept. Now, the issue is we would like to do this for really all Intel processors because we don't know if the function changes or anything. So the function is undocumented by Intel, but by luck we have some sort of debug mod for the processors that are the hardware performance counters. So the hardware performance counters Their goal is to monitor a collection of events really at the processor level. We have different performance monitoring units in the processor, and in particular we have one performance monitoring unit per slice of the core. So they are called CBO or C-boxes. And we can access this performance control via processor-dependent model-specific registers. So it basically works like this. We have one address. So the hash function says it's going to go in slice 0. So it first goes to the CBO 0, and it has plus 1 to the LSC lookup event. So the LSC lookup event is an event on specifically the CBO, and it comes with the accesses to one slice. So here we add plus 1 to this LSC lookup event for this slice. Another address will go to slice 2, it will add plus 1 to the LSC lookup event, and so on for every other address. So what we would like to have is a mapping between physical addresses and slices. So we're going to translate virtual addresses to physical addresses. Then we're going to set up a monitoring session and repeatedly access one single address. And then we're going to read the LSC lookup event for each CPU. So this is the result for four different addresses and each CBO. So we can clearly see that if we access the addresses enough, we will have a clear, for each address, one CBO that has been accessed way more than the others. Here the access is logarithmic. So it's really clear that each address has been mapped to one CBO. So each address is mapped to one slice. Now, we have this sort of huge mapping because we have virtually all physical addresses and which correspond to two slices, but we would like to have a function because, well, it said that it is a function, so we want to reconstruct this function. So we have a problem that is Boolean function minimization problem. Unfortunately, it's a very hard problem. It doesn't mean that it's impossible to solve, but just it can be very long. So, we tried to fed it to the state-of-the-art tool for this, which is called Espresso. And so we have this crucible of really hundreds of millions of lines, and fedding it to it. 2 months later, it was still running, and I'm pretty sure that it would still be running now if I hadn't stopped it. So, we can't really wait to have the answer for this. We need some hints on what the function looks like. So what I did is I manually reconstructed the function for one processor, which is the one TMP5 IFA bridge. So it's a quad core, so I have 2 bits of output, which I divided into 2 functions, O0 and O1. And to reconstruct the function, so I search pattern in contiguous physical memory. So really performing regular accesses to fix every bit but the one I wanted to observe. And so in the end I had like huge pile of zeros and one on sheets of paper and trying to correlate the output with the input. So fortunately for me, the function was still quite simple. It has only XORs, and this is what I retrieved. Now, I had kind of the same issue I had at the beginning. I have the function for one processor, but it doesn't tell me what is it for the other processors. So knowing that it is on XORed, it allowed us to automatically reconstruct the function. In particular, we could access only a handful of addresses, so it's a very fast process, and we generalized it for all processors with upper of 2 number of cores. So for each bit of output, each function O0, O1, O2, we found 2 addresses that differ by a single bit, so in input. And we compare the output for these 2 addresses. So if the output is different, it means that the bit is part of the function and it's going to be XORed with the others. If the output is equal for these 2 addresses, it means that the bit is not part of the function and we go to the other bit. So we evaluated this approach on 8 processors of recent microarchitectures, so Sandy Bridge, Ivy Bridge, and as well. For Xeon M cores and processors of 2, 4, and 8 cores. And this is basically what we found. So we have 2 important insights on this. The first one is that we have, in fact, only three functions. So you can see that O0 for two cores is the same as O0 for four cores and O0 for eight cores, and O1 for four cores is the same as O1 for eight cores. So in the NVM, we have this O0, O1, and O2. There is also the work of Kundeta previously, and we found additional insights on this. In particular, our method is more direct because it allows really to map one physical address to one slice, which wasn't the case before, and it allowed us to retrieve more bits. In particular, bits 6 to 16, it's not possible to retrieve them with Kundeta methods. So our first application was to perform a fast cache cover channel. So this is something that was quite similar to other prime plus probe attacks on last level cache. We leverage the inclusive property of the last level cache, and basically what we do is that we create a set of addresses using the addressing function that allows us to evict the line of the receiver. So the sender evicts a lot of lines of the receiver, and they can communicate via these short and long accesses. So doing this, we have a bitrate that is approximately 200 kilobits per second. So now the second application was building Warhammer.js. So this is a joint work with Daniel Goose and Stefan Munger. So as Max Ebon explained later, so we have we have Warhammer that is not a typical cache attack. It's a zero vulnerability in which if you repeatedly access DRAM, it can cause bit flips out of the part we accessed. So what is really critical in this attack is to have non-cache accesses, because if you just perform accesses, it will go in the cache and it won't reach the DRAM and it will not cause the bit flips. So the previous work on this always used CL flush to flush the line from the cache hierarchy. And the issue with this is that if you want to perform the attack in JavaScript, the CL flush instruction is not available. So what we did is really similar to the previous cache attacks. Knowing the addressing function, we created an eviction set to evict the line of the attacker that wants to reach the DRAM and cause the bit flips. So, doing this, we showed that it is possible to trigger bit flips without CL flush in native environment and in JavaScript, even if there are less bit flips because it takes a bit longer to evict data from with this function than with the CL flush. Still, we were able to perform a remote hardware fault attack from a victim proposal doing this. So there have been, apparently it's kind of a hot topic because there have been some concurrent work. So just after we submitted our article, there have been work of Erasuk et al. Who performed the reverse engineering on four of two number of core CPUs. But they were using the method of Kundeta, so they had the same issue. They were also missing some bits. And there have been also the work of INSI et al. They performed it on a 10-core CPU and subsequently performed an attack directly on Amazon EC2. And finally, Yuval et al. Performed it on a 6-core CPU. Now, we have really a sort of patchwork of articles now. What would be interesting is to use our method to automate the reverse engineering for processors that don't have 4 of 2 number of cores, so to address the work also of INSI et al. And Yuval et al., but more generalizing. And it's also interesting to see if there could be new attacks or new countermeasures knowing this function. So, as a summary, we reverse engineering the complex addressing function for Intel processors that have a 4 of 2 number of cores. It allows more fine-grain attacks, in particular improving cache attacks and demonstrating a novel hardware fault attack. And there have been lots of propositions. Well, one main proposition to counter this attack was to disable the CL flush instruction, but it's actually not an effective countermeasure either for cache attacks or even room harm, because even without this CL flush instruction, using this function we can evict lines of the hierarchy of caches. So this concludes my talk. If you have any questions.
So we have time for questions. Anyone wants to have the microphone? Well, somebody does. So it's actually pretty interesting work. I was wondering if you actually, so do you have any thoughts on, like, when you talk about countermeasures, is there any way, for example, to answer randomness on how they, you know, passive function works and routes writes to the different slices?
So to change the function as a countermeasure?
Yes, change the function, right, or add something that basically will not allow you to, you know, reverse engineer offline and then perform an attack online.
Yeah, so this is something that is a bit tricky because we cannot just add randomness because the function needs to be deterministic to be able to just retrieve the lines. I mean, the processor have to be able to retrieve the lines. Now we could have some function that is more complex, but this function is really, this is time critical. It has to be very fast because the line has to be retrieved very fast. And I don't think manufacturer would implement something that is complex in this function. So it has to be deterministic and simple. Even if they change the mechanism, I'm pretty sure that we could still be able to reverse some generators.
Any questions? So let me ask one more question until the speaker shuts up. So one is, so you tried the kind of, let's say, black box testing, and obviously the space was too big to explore. So I was wondering, so do you think basically the fact that the manufacturers cannot do very complex stuff will maintain your assumptions about this has function looks like, so you can use your method in future processors?
Yes, I think it would be possible. Well, first, the hash function hasn't changed in the at least these three macro architectures we tested. We also tested it in the new ones, so I think we tested it in Skylake processors, and it was still the same. So, so first, I'm not sure that they are really eager to find a new one, and it would have to be even more performant. And yeah, I think that. Given the assumptions of this, it has to be very performant, it has to be deterministic. I'm pretty sure that, if the performance control stay here, we would be able to find the function for newer processors. Yeah. If it changes at all, which is, I'm not even sure that's the case.
Thank you.
Yeah. So would the solution be to use cache coloring? This particular case, you actually separate the caches for, I don't know, just for the browser, I guess, just make sure that the browser runs in its own set of cache logs.
Yes, this is one solution, and in fact, here having the complex addressing allows us for even more fine grained page coloring, which is a good thing because basically the countermeasures are not really applied in the cache. There is really a lot of work on countermeasures on the hardware side, so apparently manufacturers are not too eager to put that on the software side. Page coloring is one of the solutions. Usually we have a huge performance degradation, and since the cache is really here for performance, nobody wants to really apply such countermeasures. But here we can have more fine-grained page coloring, so maybe it will help to have less performance degradation and maybe have it